we saw how to create a multi-line string. Later on, we saw like how can you access each individual character of a string. So basically, we went into a little deep and saw the concept of indexing. We saw that in Python, indexing starts from zero, right? The position number always starts from zero. If you're counting the characters in a string, or if you're counting the number of elements in a list, everything will start from zero. All the indexes will start from zero. So you have to accordingly use the indexes while accessing any element of these sequence types. That's why, again, that is why it's called sequence, because you have certain elements grouped together. Then we saw on all the three data types. I think the tuples we did not see last time. We did not have much time for it. But I said accessing and slicing operations for tuples is exactly the same as lists. I think today we'll start with I'll just give you an overview of all the operations in tuple. That was an exercise, a homework exercise. But anyway, we'll see it in the class today. And we saw how to slice the lists and how to get the substrings from a string, right? Using the start index, end index. Then in lists, we also saw one more concept where we were giving the step size, right? First would be the starting index, the next would be the ending index plus one, basically. Like if you want to get your substring from a part of the list from the zeroth element to the fourth element, then you have to give the ending index as 5, 4 plus 1, right? That we saw last time. And then we saw the step size as well. We saw like if we put the step size as 1, then we'll get all the elements in the interval there that you are providing to Python, right? If your start index to end index would be the interval. And if your step size is 1, then all the elements in that interval will be accessed by Python for you. But if you give the step size as 2, then it will skip one element in between, right? It will print out alternate elements. Again, we saw that if we want to print a list in the reverse order, then what is the step size that we have to provide? Any answers? If you want to print a list in the reverse order, then what is the step size that we were providing last time?
Minus one.
Yeah, right. Minus one we are providing, right? So minus one is basically stepping from the opposite direction, stepping from the opposite side. So since it is one, since you have given minus one, so every element will be printed, but just from the back side, just from the reverse side. If you give us minus two, if you give the step size as minus two, then every second element will be printed in the reverse order. That is, the list will be printed alternatively. Like the last element will be printed, then second to last element will not be printed, third to last element will be printed. But this would happen in an alternate way. That is, one element in between would skip. So it would be the same as giving two as step size, but the order of the list would be reverse. Then we saw that strings are immutable. Immutable as in once you have created a string, once I have a string, say hello, okay, and I want to change the second character of the string, so that is not possible, because immutable means you cannot change an object or you cannot change a string once you have created it. So if strings are immutable, that means once you have created a string, you cannot change the characters of the string. If you have made a mistake and you want to change any character of the string, then you have to declare a whole new string. Okay, you cannot change the same string again. So then we saw accessing the characters in a string using the indexes. And we saw the concept of indexes as we discussed. Then we saw some operations that we can perform on string, that is addition operation and multiplication operation. Then we saw this basically using percentage signs, right? String formatters, as you call them. String formatters, which is basically the percentage, the modulus sign. So as to put the variables in between your sentences. So if you want to put some variables, right, in this case str1, in the second case, In the second case, str1, str2, and add are three variables that you want to put into your sentence, addition of like whatever sentence you're printing. So instead of putting plus signs, you can direct put a percent s, so that that is a string format basically. So the number of percent s or percentage signs in your string should be the number of variables that you have to place in those blanks. So in this case, right, addition of percent s and percent s is percent s. So I have 3% s in my statement, right, in my sentence. So I'll need three variables to be added in those places. So in this case, I have to put in, like after the sentence gets done, you have to put a comma, and then you have to put all the variables that you want to be placed inside those percent s. Like these percent s is kind of placeholder. Okay, it's a placeholder as in like now that I have 3% s here, at the end of a sentence, when I'm putting percent, like this, at the end of the sentence, we are putting this percentage, right? After that, I have to give three variable names because I have 3% s in my sentence. Okay, and you have to put it in the in that particular order only. Like the first percent s will be mapped to the first variable, the second percent s will be mapped to the second variable, and third percent s will be mapped to the third variable. So like the same thing we can do with integers also. For integers, you have to use percent i. Similarly, last time we saw for float, we will use percent f. By default, the number of decimal places would be 6. You can get as many decimal places as you want by specifying it as well. Is this clear till here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. What about others? Any question?
No, ma'am.
Okay, then we saw lists. Yeah, cool. Let me know if anyone has any questions. Then we saw the concept of lists. Lists are used to store multiple elements. Now these elements can be of any varying data types. That means you do not have to, it's not mandatory, it's not necessary for you to create a list with the same data type. You can create a list with elements that are of multiple data types. Like you can put an integer and a string together in a list, and that would be totally fine. So yeah, contains items of any data type.
We cannot put the data types different in a list.
No, that's what I'm saying. You can put any data type. Like, okay, let's just see that once. So if I have a list, right, I can put in any data type in that. Okay, I can put 2, 3, and then I can put a string, and then put a float in this, and this would be totally fine. This is totally fine with Python. So you have all the data types and it's totally fine. So yeah, then we saw certain like operations, right? Certain functions that you can use on the list. To get the length of the list, you can use the len function. To keep on adding more elements to the list, you can use the append function. To remove elements from list, remove elements as in the remove the first occurrence. Like inside this remove, you will have to specify an element, right? So in this case, if I have to remove the number 3, so I'll say list dot remove 3. So what this remove function will do is it will remove the first instance of 3. That is, in the list, it will start going, it will start iterating. Like it will start going through each element. That is called iterating. When in a list, if Python will go through each element of that list, then Python is basically iterating the list, okay? So here, in this case, Python will start iterating the list from the first element. It will see 2, then it will see 3. Okay, it found 3, whatever number or whatever element you have given. It found that element in the list, then it will eliminate or it will delete that element from the list. And that's it. So it will just delete the first occurrence. So in this case, probably it won't be visible. Okay, so if I have 2 occurrences of 3 in my list, only the first one will get deleted. So I have one occurrence of 3 before apple, and the second occurrence I'm putting it after apple. Okay, so yeah. And after this, I'm going to remove 3 from the list and see what happens. 3, and then print the list. So here you can see there's 1, 3 before Apple, 1, 3 after Apple. After I have removed, if I have used that function, right, remove function, the 3 before Apple goes away. Why does it go away? Because remove function will remove the first occurrence of the element. Okay, in this case, the first occurrence of the element was 3 before Apple, right? You will start iterating the list from the first element. So Python will go to 2, Python will go to 3, then it will go to Apple, then it will go to the next 3. So in this way, the first three, right, after 2, that would be the first occurrence of 3 in the list. So Python will delete that element from the list, the first occurrence. So yeah, that is there. And the indexes over here also start with 0. And lists are mutable. That means you can edit or you can change the elements of the list. It is basically, if I have a list, I can just say list of 1 is equal to 4. Okay, let's just remove this simplicity. Okay, so what would be printed in this case? What will be printed in this case?
3.
No, I'm not printing one character. Like, I have changed one element of the list, right? I have made the second element of the list as 4. List of 1 is equal to 4, I have made, right? So, second element is become.
So, we'll get 2, 4, Apple, and 3, ma'am.
Yeah, right. We'll get 2, 4, Apple, and 3. So, it just changed the 3 element to 4. Okay.
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay. So yeah, this is done. Then we saw list slicing and list accessing. So accessing, just as we saw here, right? List of 1. Or if I want to print it, I can just print list of 2. So this is basically accessing the elements of the list with the index. Then you have slicing the list, which is just getting a part of the list, whole list. That also is exactly the same as for string. So you can use list. Starting element, starting address, which I'll take. So now if I want to print 3 and Apple, just 3 and Apple. So in this case, my starting index is 1 because I want 3 and Apple, right? So my starting index is 1 and ending index would be, now what is the index of Apple here?
Index of Apple is 2, ma'am, but we have to give the index as 3, then only we'll get Apple.
Yeah, right. Good, yeah. So your ending index would be whatever is the last or whatever is the index of the last element that you need plus 1. Okay, and then if you want step size, that you can mention after one more colon. So yeah, now I have 4 and Apple. So this is done, and then we saw like if we can also skip the starting or ending index. So if I skip the starting index, Python will consider it from the start of the list. If I skip the ending index, then Python will consider it to the end of the list. So if I say print list two, three, so what should be the answer?
Two, three, Apple.
Should Apple be there? Apple should be there. Yeah. It should be 2, 4 Apple, basically, because we changed 3 to 4, right, over here.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So similarly, if I say print list of 2, empty, I mean no value, then what should that answer be? What should be printed?
3.
Apple and 3, ma'am.
Yeah, Apple and 3. Do you starting index we always mention as it is, right? Starting index here 2 I have mentioned, so 2 at position 2 we have Apple. So it will start from Apple and go till the end of the list. yeah, this is done. Then we had tuples. Now tuples is kind of same as list. We saw that even tuples has multiple elements and you can access those elements using index. The difference is there are two differences between lists and tuples. The first one is that while creating a list, you use square brackets, right? Square open and close brackets. But while creating a tuple, you will use rounded brackets or parentheses, as we saw that last time. They are called as parentheses. So you will use open and close parentheses to create a tuple. Okay, and lists are mutable, but tuples are immutable. That means you cannot change the elements of the tuples after it is created. Okay, and indexing and slicing. Yeah, cool. Indexing and slicing will work the same way as we saw in lists, and we will use tuples instead of lists when we do not want the data to be modified. Like we said, right, tuples are immutable. So once you've created a tuple, you cannot change the elements of the tuple, right? So if we don't want the previous elements to be changed in any form, so if I create a list, example, if I'm creating a list, if I have like four elements in the list, now I can either change, I can change the previous elements, right? I can change any of the previous elements. I can add the another element to the list also. But we will use tuples when we just want to add elements to the tuple. We do not want to change any of the existing elements in the tuple.
If we want to change when we use to list.
Yeah, right, exactly. If you want to change any of the elements in the like the already existing elements in the list, then in that case you will use a list. If you do not want to change, then you will use a tuple. Also, whenever there is more data, right, so in some internal processing will happen, right, inside your systems. So in that case, if there is a lot of data that you're working on, like if you have like 20,000, 30,000 records, then tuples would be easy, like tuples will process faster. Okay, so we'll see that we can add two tuples and all, right? So also if you are accessing data from a tuple, if you want to get a data from a tuple, and if you compare that with getting data element from the list, so when your list and tuple is small, you probably won't understand it that much. But if your list and tuples are very big, like if you have like 30,000, 40,000 elements in the list and tuple, then in that case, tuples will work a little faster than lists. That's why tuples are used. That is one more advantage of using a tuple. Later on, we saw operator precedence and associativity. So operator precedence, as we saw, that was basically what you guys must have learned in mathematics. Okay, so which is basically if you have multiple operators in one expression, which operator will be executed first? Which operator will be evaluated first, basically? So that we saw that it uses some specific order, some specific table we saw, this table, wherein you can see parentheses or that open and close round bracket has the topmost precedence, which means if in any of the expression, if a parenthesis is present, if this operator is present, then whatever is present inside the parenthesis will be executed or will be evaluated first. Then you have exponent, then you have multiplication, division, addition. We skip bitwise. Then we have relational operators. So all this we saw last time, right? Then there was a concept of associativity. So basically now if you have multiple operators in one expression, which are in the same level in the table, okay? Like if you have multiplication and division in the same expression. So now both multiplication and division here, if you see the third, this right row, right? So multiplication and division are present in the same expression and they are present in the same row itself. So you cannot identify which one has greater precedence, which means which one will be the first to get evaluated. So in that case, you have the concept of associativity. So associativity also, you have a certain table for that. You can just refer the table whenever you are working with so many operators. No need of keeping it in mind, no need of by-hatting it or anything. Everything is available on the internet. And whenever you're working with programming languages, right? So first thing is all you have to understand very nicely is the concepts behind it. Like if we are like in future, we'll see how loops work or how functions work, right? How to create a function, how to create a loop. That is more important than these small things. Because these small things, you can easily just go to internet and check it whenever you're working. That is totally fine. Like even if I have used Python for like 3-4 years now, and I don't remember all these things like associativity and what is the precedence of what operator. So all these things, you can just look it through the internet whenever you want. But the most important thing is you have to understand the concepts, like basic concepts, like which might be useful in all the other programming languages as well. So here you have the concept of associativity. So whenever you have multiple operators in the same expression and all of them are on the same level in the table, in the precedence table, then you will look into the associativity table. So in associativity, if it says left to right, okay, then what does that mean? Anyone? If associativity table here, if I have suppose multiplication and division in the same line, so if I have something like,
is it what? Ma'am, associative means if we have three numbers and two operations, it will do both.
If multiplication of addition.
Okay, just a second. So basically, what associativity means is if you have multiple operators on the same level. Okay, so now if I have a plus and a multiplication, if I have this plus and multiplication, so now in this case, will you be able to tell me what will be executed first?
Multiplication.
Right. Multiplication will be executed first because according to the table, the multiplication sign comes before the addition sign, right? Multiplication is on third row and addition is on fourth row. So multiplication comes before addition. So that's why if you have an expression like this, then in that case, multiplication will be executed first and addition would be executed later on. Okay. But now if I have a division operator here instead of plus operator, now I cannot easily understand, right? Because both multiplication and division are present on the same row. Present in the same row. Both of them have the same precedence. Okay. So in this case, you look into the associativity column. So when it says is left to right associativity, that means whatever your expression is, your evaluation will start from the left hand side. Okay. Which means whatever operator is present, the first operator present on the left hand side will be evaluated first. Okay. So in this case, what will be evaluated first?
Division, exactly, right.
So correct. So that is what left to right associativity means. And then you have right to left associativity. So I think right to left is very less. Mostly all of these operators follow left to right only. So right to left is exactly the same, but basically your evaluation starts from the right hand side. So one of the this examples of right to left is this exponent operator, right? So in this case, your 5 raised to 2 will be executed first, or maybe just make it 2. So
5 raised to 2, 3.
So 2 raised to 2 will be executed first, which the answer would be 4, right? So that 4 will be used instead of 2 raised to 2. And then the next time it gets evaluated, it will be 3 raised to 4. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, cool. So yeah, that is it about what we saw last time. So we had some questions to be done last time, given as homework. So if any one of you has tried it, you can tell me. You can
see. Yeah, ma'am, I tried question.
Okay, great. So the first one was to get a name from the user and to check if the vowels are present in the name or not. Okay. So yeah, I think you can share your screen and we'll see your code.
Okay.
Okay, great. Can you show your code once? Okay, fine. So this is not exactly what the question is, but yeah, right. I mean, this will clear your concepts as well. My only, this was, like this homework was given so that you get a little bit more familiar with lists. So I think, yeah, I think that using of in is proper. You are checking if the character is present in the list or not. That is proper. Okay, this is the second one, right? Okay, good. Okay. In this case, you're checking if that chocolate is present in the list or not, right?
Yeah, right.
Okay, once getting from user and check if it's available. Okay, so you also had to add a chocolate given from the user to your list, and also to give the length of the chocolate, like whatever list you already have, you had to give the length of the list as well. But that's fine. I hope you've understood the concepts. Like, I think for both of these things, you used lists, right? So you have some more familiarity with lists now. You can work with lists properly.
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay, cool. Okay. Anyone else who wants to show their code? Anyone wants to show their code? No? I think some unknown sender has done the assignment, right? You have put it on the chat. I can't like gather your name because it's showing as unknown sender. So if you want, if you've done it, you can show it in the class if you want. Okay, no one. Okay. Fine. Maybe I'll just go through the questions and the code ones. For everyone. Okay, so the first question was that you had to get the name of the user, and you had to check if the vowels are present in the name of the user or not. Okay, so now we have vowels A, E, I, O, U, right? So what I want to check is, what is my problem statement, or what is it that I am trying to accomplish here, is that when I'm getting a name from the user, I have to check if either of this A, E, I, O, U are present in the name or not. Even if one of the vowels is present, I will print as, okay, some vowel is present inside this name. Okay, so let's go back. So this is just one way of doing it, what I'll be showing you, simple way of doing it. Okay, so here, as you can see, I'm taking the name from the user, okay? And now I'm here individually, I am checking, okay, if A is present in the name, E is present in the name, I is present in the name, O is present in the name, or U is present in the name. So now what type of data will be stored in this variable? Is A, is E, is I? What type of variable will be stored here?
String, ma'am.
Okay, Boolean data type, right? That's what I wanted to say. Okay, yeah, right. True would be there. Okay, or yeah, true or false. Okay, either of those two. Okay, Boolean value would be stored in that. Okay, now my question is, if that name, right, the name that I'm getting from the user, if it has any of these one. So even if one of A, E, I, O, U is present, okay, either of them is present, and I will print saying it is true that the name contains vowels, okay. So in this case, what I'm checking is, I'm using OR operator, okay. I'm using OR operator four times. So basically, I'm saying is A, or is E, or is I, or is O, or is U. Okay, so even if one of, so that's what we saw earlier, right, that whenever there is an OR operation involved, okay, whenever there is an OR operation involved, you get a value of true if one of those two operands is true, right? If either of those two operands is true, okay, if we consider just this much, like this one, is A or is E, then if either of these two, if the name contains either A or if the name contains E, then I will get the answer to be true, right? So here exactly that I've done, I've just used OR operator multiple times, okay? Now whenever you have multiple operators, so this is more than one times I'm using an operator, right? So I have multiple operators in one sentence, right? In one statement, basically, in one expression. Okay, so I will check the rules of precedence and see from where does it start. So right now here too, anyway, we are going to get the answer as true or false only. Let's just go through the precedence once and see like how exactly internally this is getting operated, this is getting evaluated. Okay, so now I have four operators in a single expression, right? So I will check first. So here in this case, do you think precedence needs to be checked?
Sorry, can you repeat it again?
Okay. I'll just repeat the whole thing again. See, I have this name, right? I have my name that I'm taking from the user. Okay, I want to check if any of these A, E, I, O, U are present in the name, which means I'll return a value. I want that the value should be true in case any of A, E, I, O, U is present in the username. Okay, any of these alphabet, any of these characters is present in the name, then I want the answer to be true. Okay, so that's why I'm using an OR operator. Okay, why are we using OR operator? Because like you know that whenever we have an OR operator, if either of the operands is true, then I get the answer to be true, right? So if I have just is A or is E, okay, not this one, just is A or is E. So in this case,
can I
if
repeat that again, I'm not okay. Getting it.
Okay. So okay, are you getting what we are trying to do here? Like we are trying to see if the vowels are present in the name or not, right? So now I want to check if any of the vowels, that is A, E, I, O, U, is present in the name or not. Okay, so even if one of these vowels is present, I will say that there is one vowel in the name. So my answer should be true in that case. Okay, so again, my answer should be true if any one of these characters is present inside the name. And my answer should be false if all of these characters are not present. None of these characters are present in my name. Okay. So again, I want my answer to be true when if any of these characters are present in the name, and I want the answer to be false if none of these characters are present in the name. Okay. Now, when we saw logical operators, right, there was one logical operator which we used to check if either of the operand is true or not, right? So OR operator is used whenever we are using OR operator, right? We get an answer of true if either of these operators is true, right? If we have A or B, just a second. Okay. If we have A is equal to true and B is equal to false, then what will be the value of A or B?
False. No, true,
right?
True.
Okay. So so now if I add one more operand and I say this is to be true, okay, and I just add one more operator here with D, now what should the value be?
False. Okay,
the value should still be true. Okay, so that's what we are trying to see internally what happens here. Okay, so let's break it down to the simplest level. Now we saw operator precedence and operator associativity, right? So in this case I have two operators, right? I have two OR operators in the same expression. Okay, I'm telling you how to evaluate this sentence to get the answer. Okay, this you could evaluate easily, right? You could say A or B. In this case, the answer would be true because A is true and B is false. Okay, so similarly, we are trying to evaluate what should be the answer of this one, A or B or D. Okay, so first thing, now since we have two operators, okay, do you think we need to check the precedence in this case?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so okay, again we talked about it, right? Whenever there is one operator, like you check precedence when there are multiple different operators. Okay, now there's no point of checking precedence in this case, right? Because both of them are the same operators, right? So even if I check the table, both will be the same operator, which is basically both of them will be present in the same row, right? Because it's the same operator. Got it? So there's no point of checking precedence here. Precedence, when do you check? When you have a plus and a multiplication sign. So both plus and multiplication sign are on different columns of the this precedence table, right? So we check precedence to see which one comes above the other, right? So in case I had like a less than and a greater than. So less than and greater than are on the same row. Okay, if you have a plus and a exponent, okay, then in that case, what should be the one evaluated first?
Exponent.
Yeah, right? Because exponent comes above plus sign, right? But in this case, I have two OR operators. Okay, even if you check the table, your OR operator would be on the same line, right? Basically, you have two similar operators, so you cannot identify, like, they would be at the same level of precedence, right? Is this clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Right? So, in this case, we will not check the precedence. Why? Because we have the same operator. Okay, so there's no point of checking precedence, because whenever you have same operator, they both operators will be at the same precedence level only. It's the same operator. Like there's no, like in this case, both the ORs will be at the same row only, right? Because it's just one operator at the end. So there's no point of checking precedence in this case. So what we will check is the associativity. Okay, so now, as we saw before, whenever you have two operators that are present on the same row with the same precedence, okay, so in this case, I just have one operator OR, but it has the same precedence, right? Both the OR operators will have the same precedence. So in this case, I'll just directly check the associativity. Okay, so here, let's see, associativity is left to right. Okay, so what it will do is it will go from left side to right side. So what is the expression that would be evaluated first in this case?
D or B.
D or B.
Left to right, not right to left.
A okay. Or B.
Exactly. So first expression that will get evaluated would be A or B, right? And what will be the answer for A or B?
True.
Right? So now we have true or D, right? This would be the intermediate expression, right? A or B, the result of A or B you got is true. And now you're ORing it with D, okay? So D is true in this case, right? So now what should be your answer? True or true?
True.
True, right?
True.
Right, great. So now your answer should be true in this case. So C would be true in this case. So let's just go and check. True, right? So this is on a higher level, right? But basically what you have to understand, this is on a higher level. Every time you use OR, you cannot do this internal whatever evaluation we did right now. So every time you cannot do this. So basically what you have to remember is when you have multiple this operators, right? Multiple operands using the OR operator. So if you have some E or F or whatever, how many ever operands you want. Okay, so whenever this is the case, your answer will always be true if that there is at least one true in this whole, any of these operands is true. Okay, your answer will be true if any of these operands is true. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah? So similarly, what we are doing here is, I want to see if my name has any one of these characters, A-E-I-O-U, which means if any one of these characters is present in the name, then that one value would be true, right? Probably if just one of the characters is present, probably only A is present in the name, then the first variable would be true, all the others would be false, right? But but if I use an or, then I'll still get an answer of true. So basically, in this case, what we are checking is I want any one of these, at least any one of these to be true. Okay, I want at least one vowel in my name. So that's why we are using OR operator. Because if any one of these operands is true, then my final answer would be true. Right? Which means if any one of the vowels is present in my name, in the name that is provided, then I want the answer to be true. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this code is clear now, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay. Just check it once. Yeah, the name contains vowels. So I have an I and A in my name, right? So I have two characters in my name. So like it will print as true. Like if it's more than one, anything will print true. Like if I use a name which does not have any vowel, I don't know if that such a kind of name exists.
Mel's kind.
Okay. Yeah. So in this case, I got the value of false because neither of those values were true. Neither of these variables were true, which means all of these variables, right? A, E, I, O, U, all of them were false. And when we have both the operands as false, then my answer would be false if I'm using OR, right? My answer would be true only if one of the operators is true. So in this case, none of my operators was true. Any question?
Okay, we have either one operand is true. It should be.
Yeah. So that's how OR works. Okay. If you are using multiple OR, your answer will final answer will be true if any one of those operands is true. Okay. And is the exact opposite of it, which means and will only work if all of the operators are true. Okay. So if I say is all operators. So whenever I want to check if is any, so I'll just name this as is any vowel, which means if there is at least one vowel in the name, if that is what I want to check, I'll use or. And if I want to check is all vowels present, which means I want that the word, whatever word is being used, given by the user, that should have all the vowels present, which means I want all of these variables to be true. Okay, I want A also to be true. I want E also to be true. Is I or is O or is U? So I want all of these to be true. In that case, I'll use, sorry, and. Okay, so if I want all of these operators to be true, then I will use AND in this case. So when is AND true? When does AND return true? When both the operators are?
True,
right? Even if any one of the operators is false, then AND will return me a false value. Okay, AND means it needs both of the operators to be true. And OR means it needs at least one operator to be true. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, so this is done. Then let's see the second exercise. I think I think that we'll just directly go to the third one because we had not seen all the operations that we can perform with tuples, right? So maybe we can see that directly. The second one is pretty simple. So just a minute. Yeah, the second one is pretty simple. So all you had to do was you had to come up with a list. Right? A list of all the chocolates probably that the company is selling, any of your favorite chocolates. Then you have to provide the user with the number of chocolate options present. So if my list name is list, L-I-S-T, then how do I get the number of chocolate options present at the company? I basically have to get the number of elements present in the list, right? Because my list is containing all the chocolates that the company is providing. Right? So how will I get that number of chocolates?
Length.
Right? Yeah. What is the function name?
Length.
The function name, can you spell it?
L-E-N.
L-E-N.
Yeah, right. Len. Okay. So the next is get the chocolate name from user and check if it's available in the company. So I think that we saw, right? Nisha had shown her code. So in that, she had done that. So basically, whatever choice you're getting, whatever chocolate name you're getting from the user, you have to check if that is present in the list or not by using in operator, right? The chocolate name in list. Okay, in that way, you will check if that chocolate name is present in the list or not. And the third one was get one chocolate name that the user wants and add them to the list of chocolates. So in that case, you just have to use dot append, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Ma'am, once so, show that dot append, how will it work?
Okay. Okay, so if I have a list of chocolate names, if I have, suppose, Milky Bar, and any suggestions?
Cadbury.
Dairy Milk.
Milky Bar, Dairy Milk.
Dairy Milk, okay. Yeah, so if I have three names like this, okay? So if I have to give the length to the user, then I'll just say print len of list. Check if a certain value is present in the list or not. Like, I'm just getting the choice from the user. Okay, so input directly, print. Please enter the chocolate name, your favorite chocolate name. Okay, so whatever choice you have been given from the user, if so basically you can check is choice in list, is in list is equal to choice in list. Okay, in this way you can find out. So this will hold a boolean value, either true or false. So if choice is present in list, it will say true, or else it will say false. If you want to add this choice, whatever choice the user has given, if you want to add that in the list, you can just say list dot append choice, and then you can print the list. Okay, so see, it gave me the number of chocolates present in the list. I'll say 5-star. So now it has appended that 5-star to my list. It has appended, as in it has added that value to the list. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So yeah, this was it. Then we'll see some of the tuple operations.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
For strings, we can use like this for numeric numbers.
For numeric numbers, as in append for numeric numbers, that is what you're asking for.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can use, these functions, right? Dot append, dot remove, dot sort. You can use it for any data type. So if I have a list. Yeah, you can basically use it for any data type. That is list functions, right? That is the, like you're basically, this data type has that like capability that you can use append function. So it does not matter what values is present inside the list. You can just use append anywhere. That would be fine. Thank God appended. You can put in any value inside the append, irrespective of data type.
Okay.
Yeah, so let's now see some of the functionalities present in tuple. So yeah, so first thing, like when I want to create a list, okay, and if that list is empty, okay, I'll just put this, right? This is creating an empty list, right? So similarly, when you're creating a tuple, if I want to create an empty tuple, I'll just say this. This is clear? Creating an empty tuple.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay. Now, if I want to create one a list with one element, okay? So, I'll say this, right? List with one element. So, I'll say this. That's it. Okay? But if I want to create a tuple with one element, you cannot put this. I'll tell you why you cannot put this. So the basic the syntax of creating a tuple with one element is to put the element name, whatever is the element, and put a comma after that. So in this way, your tuple will be created with value 1. Just one single value in it. That value can be anything. I'll say.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, again, in case of tuple, your tuple can hold multiple data types. It's not necessary to have a similar single data type. Okay, so now why is this? I'll tell you. So when I create it using a comma right after the first element, what I'm getting is a tuple, right? If I type the type of it, of what type it is, then in that case, it will give me a tuple, class tuple, right? But when I create a tuple or try to create something, some element, using just this, or let's say just 3 to make the understanding easier. Okay, so what this will do is it won't consider 3 as a tuple, it will consider this as a integer, like because we saw, right, parenthesis is also an operator. Right, we saw whatever is present inside the parenthesis gets evaluated, right? So in this case, Python will basically evaluate that parenthesis and consider whatever is the value after evaluation to be like, basically in this case, if you evaluate the value, the answer would be 3, right? It's just like a basic math equation. Whenever you're writing a math equation, if you write some integer inside parenthesis, so that is the value of the integer, right? That is, so in this case, similarly here, if you just put this, then Python will consider the evaluation, whatever is the final result, as an integer and not as a tuple. So see, it has created an int instead of tuple. So to create a tuple, you have to put a comma after the first element, if you are just using one element. So yeah, that is one thing. So now if I want to add some values to a tuple, right? If I want to add some 2-3 more fruit names to this TUP tuple, okay? So here in case of tuple, dot append does not work, okay? So in this case, I'll just say plus again, okay? So now I want to add it to the same tuple, right? I want to add 2 more fruit names to the same tuple TUP. Okay, so what I'll do is TUP is equal to TUP plus, I'll add whatever fruit names I want. Mango, peach, probably. Peach. Okay, so yeah, so it will add those 2 values in tuple.
Ma'am, comma after peach is missing.
No, so that's what we said, right? When you are creating a tuple with one value, okay, with one single value, in that case you require a comma. If you are creating 2 values, if you're creating a tuple with two values, there does not need to be a comma at the end of the second this element.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
That, because in this case there is no ambiguity, like there is no second meaning for this, right? But if you just put a single character or single element inside parenthesis, then there is a double meaning for it, right? It has 2 meanings, right? So in that case,
okay,
to make it clear for Python, you have to put a comma. If you have multiple elements, inside the tuple, there's no need of putting one more comma at the end. So here in this case, So here in this case, my this mango and peach will get added to the apple element inside the tuple TUP. Okay, so this is one way, and there is one more way I can do this, a simpler way, which we have been talking about since the start. Can anyone tell me? Here I'm using this tup is equal to tup plus whatever is my final tuple, right? Instead of this, there's a simple way of doing it. Okay, assignment operators, if you can think of. Anyone? I'm assigning whatever my final value is of the operation, I'm assigning it to one of the operands only. Like tup is one of my operand here, right? One operand is tup and the second operand is this mango comma peach. So I'm adding operation 1 with, I'm adding operand 1 with operand 2 and saving it in operand 1 itself. So what should I use in that case? It's similar, like if I have 10 and now I want to add 1 to 10, which is basically A plus 1 and save it inside A itself. Then there was one simpler way we did it. Anyone can, like, do you remember what was it? A simpler way of using this or doing this operation? Okay, no one? Using assignment operators? Okay, so it was basically A plus is equal to 1. We saw it right initially using this is called as an assignment operator. Plus is equal to, it was a shortcut. So when do you use it? When you have to add something to an operand and save the whole thing in the operand itself. That is basically you want to modify that operand. Okay, so in this case also similarly here we are adding this mango comma peach to this tuple. Okay, and we are going to save the whole thing inside the tuple itself. So that's why if I want to, if there's a simple way to do it, that would be tup plus is equal to whatever would be then the second operand, basically, comma peach. Clear? Is this clear? What we just did right now using plus is equal to. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. So this is one of the way, and the second way is basically you have two tuples. So if I have like T1 is equal to 1, 4 and 5, and I have T2 is equal to some 5, 7 and 8, and when I add, I can add it using T3 is equal to T1 plus T2. Okay, so basically all the operators or all the elements that are present in T1 plus all the all the elements present in T1 and all the elements present in T2, all of them will form a third tuple in this case called T3. Okay, so I print
yes,
T3,
ma'am.
All the elements of T1 and T2 should come here. So yeah, so in this case, duplicates are allowed. So you saw 5 was present in both of the T1 and T2 tuples, right? And here we have 5 twice. So first it will get all the elements from T1, that is 1, 4 and 5. And then it will get all the elements from T2, 5, 7 and 8 and add them into one single tuple. Okay, so this is one of the operations. Yeah, so if you want to use append, right, in this case, now tuples do not have the, like you cannot use dot append on a tuple, dot append or dot remove on a tuple. But what you can do is you can convert a tuple to a list, make the change and convert it back to a tuple. Okay, so what I'm saying is you have a tuple, okay, you can convert it to a list. Okay, use whatever operations you want to use, like append and remove, if you want to use these two operations, and then convert this answer back to a tuple. Back to a tuple. So yeah, so I have a tuple called T3. I'll use that T3 only. So I'll say list temp. Because it's a temporary list for me. Temporary list would be list of T3. Okay, so whenever you're using list method, okay, just as we saw, right, whenever you're using str method, whatever you put inside it will turn into a string. Whenever you're using int method, whatever you put inside it will turn into an integer. Similarly, whenever you're using a list method, whatever you put inside that will convert into a list. So in this case, my tuple will be converted into a list. Okay. So okay.
Yes, ma'am.
What was the What was the value of T3?
1, 4, 5, 7, 8, ma'am.
Yeah, 1, 4, 5, 7, 8. So that same. Yeah, 5, 7, 8. Right. Yeah. So here it was a tuple. How could you identify using with this parenthesis, right? Because there were parentheses, you could identify it's a tuple. So if I print this, right, if I print this list temp, then instead of this parenthesis, I will have square brackets, which will tell me that it is now successfully converted into a. Sorry.
Yes.
Object is not working. just a minute. Line number 31. Okay. Not sure what is wrong here. Just a minute. Okay, I'm not sure what is wrong here. Let me just check.
Ma'am, yes, we have the square brackets, right?
Sorry? Yeah, but this list is a function, right? Like basically this is a function and you're passing in something inside that function. So you don't have that square brackets are used when you want to access something. And this here in this case, we are trying to convert something into a list. Right, so we are using the list function, and functions always have like parentheses. Just a minute, let me just check. Okay. I think we'll see that later. I'll have to see what is the error in this case. Okay, so let's just move on. So basically, so I'll show this to you guys at the end. Probably I'll just see what is the error. Why is it failing at that point? So one more operation you can do with tuples is the multiplication operator. So if I have tup 4 is equal to, like, if I say perk, maybe like the perk chocolate, okay. And this is so basically it's a tuple. I've created a small tuple and I'm going to multiply it with 3, okay. So in this case, I should get like 3 times perk inside the tuple. So yeah, that's what I'm getting here, perk, perk, perk. So it just multiplied the value 3 times. Yeah, so all the slicing and accessing operators work the same way. So if you consider T3, and if I try to access like print of T3, okay, while accessing an element, you will use square brackets. So you can use whatever index you want and get the element. Similarly, slicing operators also work the same way. Okay, and now if you want to delete a tuple, right, I think this should work in case of a list as well. So whenever you want to delete any list or tuple, what you can do is you can directly say DEL, okay, DEL of T3. Now when I say DEL of T3, the T3 tuple will get removed. The T3 tuple will get erased. Okay, so Python will not understand what this T3 is. So it says T3 is not defined. That is because when I said del T3, it deleted that tuple from its memory. Now, Python does not have T3 in its memory anymore. And that's why if you try to access it, it will give you an error. So, yeah, this is... Okay, and again, max, min, len, all those things work similarly. You can try that. Max, min, and len functions work the same way. So, if I say... Can say a print max of T3. So in this case, what should be the answer? Max of T3?
8. And print min T3.
Not able to hear you. 8, right? Yeah. So the difference only is in sort. Okay, I think in list we use list dot sort, right? If you remember, whatever the list name, we use dot sort, right? And if we wanted to reverse it, we just wrote reverse is equal to true, right? Remember this? Okay. So, but in case of tuple, you cannot use use dot sort, you will use sorted function. So this is a different function used for tuples, sorted. Okay, so you say sorted of T3. Okay, so in case you do not pass any parameters, anyway, I think our this was sorted only. The tuple that we had created was sorted only. So yeah, so you can print it. And if I say comma reverse is equal to true, then in this case, it should be in the descending order. Okay, so now what I just noticed it, when you use the sorted method, I think it turns that like the output is in list, not in tuple. Let's check this. Print type of L. Yeah, see. So whenever you're using the sorted method, sorted function on any of the tuple, the output, right, whatever output you get, that would be in the form of a list, not in the form of a tuple. Okay, so to convert it back to tuple, I can just say tuple of L. Okay, again, like str and int, this will convert, this tuple will convert whatever you put inside it into a tuple. So yeah, it got converted into a tuple again. So yeah, so this is it for tuples. I think accessing and slicing we are not looking into, because I think we have looked it into for strings and for lists. So is this clear? Is this much clear? I'll check what was wrong with the list though. Let me know if something is not clear, if something is still unclear, then I'll explain it to you once again. Okay, no, I think there must be some issue. Fine, I'll get back to you guys regarding that list function.
Okay. Yes,
so is
ma'am.
Should we move ahead? Okay, let's move ahead and go and see what the So did you guys get the PPTs? Like you guys wanted to go through the PPTs, right? So I hope you have got them.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, great. Yeah. So today we'll see what are conditional statements in Python. So what does conditional statements mean is, like whatever code we have written till now, right? So if you have noticed, whenever we start executing the code, every single line from the start will keep on executing, right? Like we wrote this code, okay? So now this code has 45 lines. And when I run this code, all of these 45 lines will run, right? Right, one by one,
yes, ma'am.
Starting from the first line, all the lines will run.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, but sometimes, yeah. So sometimes you do not want some lines to work. Like sometimes you want a certain part of code to work only when certain specified condition is mentioned. Like only, like you don't want the whole code to run always. There are some parts of the code that you might not want to run always. Okay, you might only want to run it when you have certain conditions evaluated to true. Like if for example, if I want to go out for a walk, right, I'll say, okay, if it's raining right now, I won't go for a walk. Only if it is not raining, I'll go for a walk. Okay, so in case if this was translated into a Python code, okay, so in my code, I mean basically there should be some, there are some conditions wherein you want some code to be executed, and like some conditions wherein you don't want some code to be executed. That is where we use this conditional statement. If you consider it in the normal daily life scenario, like if you want to give an analogy, it basically means that if it's raining, so just now I said, right, if it is not raining, only then I'll go out for a walk. If it's raining, I will not go for a walk. So I have this if condition, right? If
your voice is very low.
Okay. Okay. Is it clear now?
No, ma'am. Voice is very low.
Okay. Just a minute. I'll just Okay, I'm not sure. Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So basically what this means is there are some conditional statements in Python. Conditional statement as in whenever you don't want the whole code to run at once, but you want a certain part of the code to run only when only when a condition is true. Okay, only when something is true. Okay, so like a real life analogy I just gave, like only if it is not raining outside will I go for a walk, or else I won't go for a walk. So similarly, while writing a code also, there will be certain part of the code which you will only want to execute when certain condition is true. So in my real life, my condition was that if it is not raining, okay, so my condition was that if it is not raining, only then I'll go for a walk, right? So in case of Python, think of it as like you want to say if it is, if certain condition is true, only then you execute this part of the code, or else you don't execute this part of the code. Okay, so that is when conditional statements are used in Python. So one of the most common conditional statements is an if block. Okay, so again, if block is exactly what I said right now. If something is true, okay, if some condition is true, only then you execute that code, or else you don't execute the code. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, this is one of the conditional statements, and this is also a code block. Okay, so we saw while writing code blocks, right? We saw a function as an example of code block earlier. So when we saw a function, okay, we saw, right, there is one statement at the top, which is the definition of the function, and everything that comes under the function should be indented. Okay, that's how it understands, like basically the concept of indentation, right? So if you had one function, if you have this def add nums, okay, so basically what we did was this is the name of the function, and everything that was present inside the function will be indented at a certain level, right? Similarly, like functions, if block is also a code block. Okay, so what this means is, I think we'll see it in the code itself. So for now, what you have to understand is you will use an if block when you want a certain part of the code to be executed only if certain condition is true. You have a condition and you have certain some part of the code. Okay, so when the condition is true, only then that code should work. Only then in that case that Python should consider those statements, or else Python should not consider those statements at all. Okay, so yeah, I guess I'll just show you example itself. It will be easier. So now what I'm trying to do is I am going to print a number. Okay, I'm going to print a number. If that number is positive, I'll take one number from the user. Okay, if I want to check if a number is positive or not, what will I do? I'll just take a number from the user. How do I check whether this number that the user is going to provide is positive or not?
Well, what? Can you repeat?
Okay, so basically I am taking one number from the user, right? I'm asking the user to provide me one number. Now I want to check if that number is positive or not. If that number is a positive number, positive integer, or a negative integer. So what should I do? Any yeses? Like I want to store if positive. Okay, I want to check if that number is positive or not. What should I do?
If
you check if a number
is,
yeah, go on.
If number is positive, else.
Don't go into the if else thing. Right now, you just tell me basically if I want to check a number is positive or not. How do you identify that a number is positive? How do you identify? Like if I give you a number 6, okay, is it positive or negative?
And we check the number by the sign.
Yeah, you check this number by the sign, that is one. And also you check it by 0, right? If that number is greater than 0, then it is a positive number, right?
Yeah, ma'am.
Right? So in this case, if I want to check if this number provided by the user is positive or not, what should I do? What should I do? Num? How do I check that it is greater than 0?
Num is positive.
Num? How do you check if it's positive or not? If it's greater than 0 or not? You use the greater than sign, right? Num greater than 0. Okay? So this num greater than 0, since this greater than is a relational operator, okay, it will tell you the answer would be in positive, false or true, right? The answer would be a boolean. Okay, so num greater than 0, will it be true or okay, so in this case, if num is a positive number which is greater than 0, then I will get is pos to be true, right?
Yes.
Ma'am, can you speak a bit loud?
I'm still not audible.
No, ma'am. You are
not okay. No, it's okay, ma'am.
Is this problem with everyone? Okay, it's okay, right? Okay, okay. So, is this much clear, like what I'm doing here? I'm just checking if whatever number you're getting from the user, if that's a positive number or not. Okay, if it's positive, then is pos will have a true value. If it's negative, then that is pos will have a false value. Okay? Okay. Now, if I want to... Yeah, this is clear. This much is clear. Now, if I want to print out the number, okay, whatever number the user has given, I want to print it out. But I want to print it out only if the number is positive. I don't want to print it if the number is negative. Okay, so this is the situation here. Okay, is this clear? Now, if I write print number provided by user, number by user, okay, if I write this, this will be printed in all cases, right? It will be printed even if the number is positive. This will be printed even if the number is negative, right? But I only want to print the number if the number given number by the user is positive. Okay, I don't want to print it in case it is negative. So in that case, what I'll do is I'll use an if statement. Okay, I'll use an if block. So what is the basic syntax of if? Like if you can see here, you have if followed by an expression. So what is an expression? Anything that will evaluate to either true or false. Okay, anything, the final value of which would be true or false. Okay, either of these two, that will be considered as an expression. So you want to check, right, if this condition is true or false. So this expression is basically your condition. Okay, and this statement is whatever code you want to execute only when this condition is true. Okay, so whenever this expression would be true, this expr, right, this condition that you will put after if this if keyword, after writing if, whatever condition you will put, if that is true, only in that case the statements will get executed, or else the statements will not get executed. Is this clear? And after this condition, you have to put a colon. Okay, I'll tell you the significance of that. This is basically the syntax of if statement. This is how you will use the if statement. And this expr, right? Again, this expr should be a value. So basically, it should be an expression that either evaluates to a true or false. Okay, you can directly put true or false also. I can say if true. So this if, right, after if, these values can either be true or can be false. It cannot be anything else, okay? So I say if true, print number or something like that, num. So in this case, now this value, this does not require any evaluation. My by default value is true only, so this will always get printed, okay? But if I want to check a condition, like in this case, if I want to say I want to print the number only if the number is positive, then I'll say if is pos and colon. And then in the next line, see again, there is an indentation, if you can see. So this is a code block, which means my first line is if is my first line, which is on indentation level 0. And everything else below that, right, whatever will come up, like come on the indentation level 1, will be the code block that will be executed when the condition is true. Okay, which means this is my statement, like we saw in the diagram, right? So this is my EXPR.
When was I doing the coding, then the error was unexpected indentation.
What? Go ahead. What error did you get?
Unexpected indentation.
Okay, what did you try?
Can you repeat?
What was that you tried? What code did you try for which you got unexpected indentation?
That was a tuple
okay,
operation.
Can you show it to us? Can you show it to us right now? Maybe we can see you did not save it. Okay. So one thing I'll tell you is, see, when you have some code block, right? When you have like an if statement or when you have a function name, in that case, suppose this is my function name. Okay, in that case, if I go I have to put any code inside these code blocks, I'll go on indentation level 1, right? This is my indentation level 1 where I'm printing something. Okay. Now, if I go to a new file and I directly go to indentation level 1 and start printing, right? If I do this, print name, I guess, something. Okay, this will fail. This will say unexpected indent. Indentation error, unexpected indent. That is because you have to, by default, you have to start on 0 indentation level only. You cannot go to, directly, you cannot go to level 1 indentation. You will go to level 1 indentation only when you are writing something inside a code block. And okay, so code block, one example of code block we saw earlier was a function. Code block, one example was a function, right? Function. Okay, in this function case, my first line, which is on indentation level 0, would be the name of the function. And whatever I'm putting inside that function will be on indentation level 1. Okay, so this is how it works. And today we will see if block, right? If else block. So that if block is also a code block. It's an example of the code block. Okay, so again, what I was trying to say is this if expression. Now, did you understand why did you get an indentation error? That is because I think you started it from level 1 indentation instead of starting it from the level 0 indentation.
No, ma'am. I started the tuple equals to 1, 2, 3.
Okay. Can you just show it once again? Like you can go to Pydroid and type whatever you had typed before that gave an error so that we can see what is the error. Are you showing? Are you going to show the? Are you going to share your screen? Yeah, cool. Okay. Yeah, see, you put a space, right? Just delete your print. See, there is one extra space, right? You should not have any spaces. It should start from the start of the line itself. Yeah, this is the correct syntax. Print is, no, don't write print is equal to, it's directly print and parenthesis. There's no is equal to in between. Yeah, cool. Now it works, right? That was because of that extra space. You should not have, yeah, go on, what?
I was putting the equal to sign.
Yeah, but that error was because you were putting a space before writing print, right? So your print, like I think that is what you did initially also, because is equal to won't give you an indentation error. Indentation error will come when you are somewhere messing up with the spaces. Okay, when you are adding probably an extra space before the start of the line, something like that. So in this case, in your case, I think what you had done before was, and before, like before writing that print, right, you were giving one space. So that is not the syntax of Python. For like Python to work properly, if your code is not inside a code block, every statement should start from indentation zero only, which is the start of the line. You cannot give any spaces at the start of the line. Okay, clear?
Thank you.
Let's just go back to this. Okay, yeah. So we were discussing if else, right? If this code block. Yeah, so this expression, you have this expression and then you have statement, right? So that statement should be on a one level ahead, like one indentation ahead of whatever if is at. So if is at indentation level zero, for this statement, whatever you will write here, whatever code you will write here in statement, that should be inside. That should be one indentation level ahead. So how do you do indentation is, like this will directly go, right? If I have a colon, Python will understand that whatever you're writing is inside some code block and it will indent it by itself. But if you want to do indentations by yourself, you just have to press this tab here. You can see right on the left hand side. So tab will give you one more level of indentation. So right now my statement, right, this statement is at zero level indentation. When I press the tab, it goes to level one indentation. So this is basically syntax of if code block. So you have an expression here which should either evaluate to true or false. So in my case, now I want to print the number only if that number is positive, or else I don't want to print the number. So my condition is that the number should be positive, right? So if number can be positive, if I'm checking if a number is positive or not, that can have two answers, either true or either false. And in this case, we are checking that using this isPos variable, right? This isPos variable has the answer to my question, whether the number is true, whether the number is positive or negative. So here in this case, I'm just going to say is underscore pos. Okay, so now if is underscore pos is true, okay, then what you should do, then you should print the number. Okay, so I'll just say number entered by user is plus num, right? So now in this case, if the user enters a positive number, only then isPos will be evaluated as true, and only when isPos is true will this statement be executed, or else it will not be executed. So let's check. So if I have 6 as the number, okay, sorry, this has to be converted to a string, to be added to a string as we saw earlier. So yeah, so now if I put 6 as the number, then, but since the number is positive, it will print that statement. It will print that line saying number entered by user is 6. But if I print, if I give a negative number like -7, then in that case, my program got finished, but that print statement did not get printed. Okay, why it did not get printed? Because my condition was not true. Okay, isPos was false in that case. isPos would have been evaluated to false. Okay, so when it got evaluated to false, this condition, right, this was false, and hence whatever was inside the if block did not get printed. Clear, everyone? What is the use of if block?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so now it's not necessary for to have just one sentence inside the if block. You can basically have multiple sentences. That is totally fine. You can have as many code lines as you want, but they should be indented. Again, if you see, both these print lines are at the same level of indentation, because you want to tell Python that these are the lines that you have to execute when the condition is true. So I'll just say print. I just separated that one sentence and written it as two code lines. So Okay, so this is where you will tell Python, okay, whatever is at level 1 indentation, whatever is at inner level, this is what you have to execute if the condition is true. And if you want to end the if block, right, anyway it gets ended here, but if I want to print something else after my end if block gets ended, right, so suppose if I want to print thank you at the end of the code, so here see, thank you I'm writing here, which is again at level 0 indentation, right? Again, it is at the extreme left-hand side. So now my question to you all is, if the number is negative, do you think thank you will get printed?
No, ma'am.
Okay, if my number is negative, do you think the thank you will get printed? It is not in the code block, right? We saw it.
Yes, ma'am, it will print, ma'am.
Yeah, it will get printed. That is because whatever we have put this condition, right, that you execute this part of the code only if the condition is true. So this condition is applied to all the statements that are at this indentation level, that are at indentation level 1. So you can see, right, after this if block, all of these statements, these two statements, line number 7 and line number 8, are on a little right-hand side. There is some space between the margin line and the statements. Okay, so this is you telling Python that whenever the if condition is true, whatever is at level 1 indentation, whatever is indented a little on the right-hand side, that is what you will execute. Okay, and if you want to, after this if condition is true, so this if condition is only valid for the statements that are at a certain indentation level. Okay, when you come back to level 0 indentation, as in line number 9, like this will apply in all the cases. This is outside of the if block, so your condition will not apply to line number 9. Line number 9 will get printed in all the cases.
Ma'am, what if when the user entered a string or something like that different from the integer?
From a number, from an integer. Okay, we'll try that as well. In this case, at least it will fail, okay, mostly because we are casting it into an integer, right? Whatever input you are getting, you are converting it into an integer, right? So I think a string will, you cannot convert a string into an integer. So if I say name, okay, some string or some apple, I guess. Apple. So the problem is when you will press enter, yeah. So you cannot convert a string into an integer. Okay, there is no way you can convert a string into an integer, right? And you're using this int function to convert whatever is the input, you want to convert it into an integer, right? So in this case, if you're entering something like alphabets, right? So in that case, alphabets cannot be converted into an integer, right? So at this point, it will throw an exception. It will fail, basically. That's what it is failing. It's saying invalid literal for int with base 10. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, so is this clear? Like, if you have an if statement, then the condition is valid. So basically, that if statement will check if a condition is true. And if that condition is true, then the statements, the code lines that are present below it at basically at level 1 indentation, you can say. At a certain indentation level, only those will be executed. Okay, once you are back on indentation level 0, then this is out of the if block. This line number 9 is out of the if block because it is not in the same indentation level as all the other statements, right? So you can see 7 and 8 are at certain indentation level, which is one level ahead of where the if this keyword is used, where if is defined, where the condition is defined. So whenever you have a condition, whatever code statement or code block that you want to execute in case the condition is true, that has to be put at plus 1 indentation level. Okay, and if you are again back to the earlier indentation level, then that means the if block will get over. Okay, so line number 9 is not a part of the if block in this case. This was for if. Okay, so we also have if else. Okay, so basically for if else, I'll just start another one, I guess. Yeah. So now in this case, what I'll do is I will tell the user if a number is even or odd.
Okay. What my objective is, I want to tell to the user if whatever number the user has given is even or odd. So how do you usually check if a number is even or odd? Anyone? How do you check if a number is even or odd? Basic mathematics? Anyone? Okay, is 2 even or odd?
Even.
Right? Is 6 even or odd?
Even.
So how did you find out that it is even?
0 plus 1 equals to even.
0 plus 1 would be odd, right? 1 is odd, right?
Yes, ma'am. Sorry. Odd, ma'am. 0 plus 1 is.
Center number. Okay. So, yeah. So, basically, any number is even if you can divide it by 2, right? That is how you check whether a number is even or odd, right? If a number is totally divided by 2 and it does not leave a remainder, okay, in that case, that number is even, right? If you have 5 as a number, for example, so 5 is not completely divided by 2, right? You will have a remainder of 1 if you try to divide 5 by 2. Is this clear? So you have a remainder of 1, right? So that's why the number is odd. Okay? Is this clear, the logic behind it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So basically, in this case, to check if a number is even or odd, I will check if what is the remainder of an expression, okay? Like basically, what remainder does it leave by division with 2. If I divide the given number with 2, what is the remainder that it gives me? Okay, that is what I will be checking. So if my remainder is 0, okay, which means the number is completely divisible by 2, then that number is even. Okay, and if the remainder is not 0, is 1, okay, in that case, that number is not completely divisible by 2, and so my answer would be odd. Is this logic clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, you guys tell me, how do I check the remainder of a number divided by 2? How do I check what is the remainder when I divide a number by 2?
5 modulus 2.
Yeah, very good. Right. So, you have number. Okay. I want to check whatever number the user has given is true or is even or odd. Right. So, I'll say num mod 2. Okay. So now what will be the data type of this remainder variable?
Mom, can you repeat?
What would be the data type of this remainder variable? What would be this remainder module. Variable?
Modulus.
Okay. No, modulus is the operator, you are right? But how will this, so if I evaluate num mod 2, okay, so if my number is 5, if the user has given the number is 5, so if I evaluate 5 mod 2, what would be the answer?
1,
right? So 1 is an integer, right? So basically, that's what I was asking, would be the data type of remainder? Okay, so the data type would be?
It will be an integer.
Integer, right? Yeah. Integer. So now in this case, what I'm trying to do is, like, if a number is odd, I'll print to the user that the number is odd. And if a number is even, I'll print to the user that the number is even. Okay? Okay. So here, if the number is even, I do not want to print the part of the code that says this number is odd. Okay, which means either of those two things should get executed. Either it is even or it is false, right? Or it is odd, right? So if the number is even, I want to print this number is even. And if the number is odd, I want to print this number is odd. Okay, but if I write print this number is even, and then I write this num is even, and then I say print this num is odd. So now, like, irrespective of the number, both these sentences will get printed, right? This is what I don't want. I want that the first line should be printed. Line number 8 should be printed only when the number is even, and the line number 9 should be printed only when the number is odd. Okay. So in this case also, we'll use an if condition. Yeah. But the problem is,
Now my, I said, right, the expression, the condition that you check in an if code block while starting any if code block after if keyword, that should be evaluated to either true or false. Okay, that should either be true or should be false. Okay, that cannot be any other thing. Okay, but this remainder that I have is in a integer format, right? Right?
Yes.
I want to convert, right? Right. So,
yes,
so in this way, what am I checking? Yes, what should, yeah, for the number to be even, what should remainder be? For the number to be even, what should the remainder be?
One. Sorry, odd.
Yeah, yeah. For the number to be even, the remainder should be zero, right?
Zero.
So that is what I'm going to check here. So basically, is even, I'm going to check. And how am I going to check that? So I want remainder to be zero, right?
Zero.
So I'm going to say, which operator, can you all guess it? Which operator will I put between remainder and zero? I want to
equals.
Okay. How many equals to should I put here?
Two.
Two.
Two. Right? Okay. Is this clear? Like we saw initially, right? You use two double equal to's. Like you use double equal to's basically when you want to check if two values are same or not. So in this case, I'm checking if remainder is equal to zero, which means if remainder is equal to zero or not. Okay. Maybe this is a bit confusing because we have used like is one more is equal to. So I'll just remove this and I'll just say if remainder is equal to zero. Okay. So now this remainder is equal to zero will evaluate into a true or a false, right? It can either be equal to zero, it can be not equal to zero. So if it is equal to zero, then my answer would be true, right? If remainder is equal to zero, which means if remainder is zero, then what should I print? The number is?
The number and the user.
Yeah, yeah, or yeah. Entered by user is even or odd?
Even.
Even, right? Okay. Okay. Now, I want to check. So, now a number can either be even or can be odd, right? There is no third option, right? If a number can either be even or can be odd. Okay. So, in this my remainder is equal to zero can be true or false. There is no third option present here. Okay. So whenever this is true, I want this to be printed. But if this is false, if remainder is equal to zero is false, which means if remainder is not equal to zero, then I want to print
else.
Okay. Then I'll just print the number.
The number entered is odd.
Odd. Right. Okay. So here if else, how did we choose to use if else? Because I had only two options. Either a number can be even or a number can be odd. Okay, so I'm checking the remainder. Okay, that is how I'm finding out if a number is even or odd, by checking the remainder that I get after dividing it by two. So that I'm checking using whatever number is given by the user, num mod 2, modulus 2, okay? So whatever remainder I get, I'm checking if that remainder is 0. If the remainder is 0, okay, so this is again evaluating into a true or false. It's evaluating into a boolean. That is what I want. Why did I not directly use remainder? Because remainder is an integer, okay? And in an if statement, you require the condition to be evaluated to one of the booleans, either true or false. Okay, so you wanted it, the answer to be true or false. So in this case, I wanted to check if whatever remainder I have, if that remainder is zero, then the number is even, or else the number is odd. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
No doubts in this one, right?
Yes, ma'am. No doubts, ma'am.
Okay, okay. I think that, so basically there here also you have certain like basically you can have multiple lines. There is no need to have only one line. You can have as many lines as you want. So here in this case I'll just write print num in both the cases. Okay, and here also, so like basically either if or else will part of the code will execute. Okay, there will never be a condition wherein all the four statements will get executed. If a condition is true, then only that part will get executed and the other will be ignored. So if my condition is true, if remainder is equal to 0, then only 9 and 10, line number 9 and 10 will be executed and 11, 12, 13 will completely be ignored. Okay, and in case 8th line, right, if remainder is equal to 0 is evaluated as false, then 9th and 10th line will be ignored and whatever is present inside else will get executed. And again, so yeah, question.
Will you run code?
Sorry?
Will you run code?
Run the code, okay, yeah, sure. Okay, so I just put 23 as the number, so the number entered is odd. Okay, and if I put any even number, then the odd part will get ignored. Okay, only that part which is present inside the if block will get executed. So this is if block and this is else block. So again, if you see the starting of the block, right, the first lines of the block are always on level 0 indentation. Okay, so if and else are at the same indentation level, but whatever is present inside it, whatever is the code block present inside if will be plus 1 indentation level, and whatever is present inside else is also at plus 1 level indentation. Right? Cool. Okay, in this case, if that's true, then whatever is at a certain indentation level, right, plus 1 indentation level beneath if statement, so all of those things will get executed. And again, after this, like if I come back here and say print thank you, so this is again at level 0 indentation level, right? So this line, will it get executed? In what all cases will this line number 14 get executed?
No.
When will this get executed, line number 14?
When the indentation level is
right.
Okay, but right now I don't have it. It has an indentation level of 0, right? It is at the same indentation level as if and else, right? So I think it's all here in this case where we had only if block. Okay, if the if condition is true, whatever is present inside the if block will get executed, and if the if condition is false, then line number 7 and 8 will not get executed. But in both the cases, this line number 9 will get executed because it is outside of the if block, right? Okay, and how did you find out that it is outside of the if block? Because it is not, like, it is at the same indentation level, yeah, as if, right? Right?
Yes,
ma'am. Here, okay, since this print thank you is at an indentation level of if and else, okay, you can understand from here that it is not a part of either of those two code blocks. Okay, because if it was a part of either of those two code blocks, it would have a certain indentation level. It would be at this indentation level. So if I say this, so in this case, thank you will only be executed if the number is odd. Okay, because it is present inside the else code block. But when I do this, okay, I am taking it out of the else code block. Now it is not a part of else code block. It is at the same level as if and else statements, which means this print is out of both of those code blocks, which means print thank you will get printed in both the cases. It will be like a next line, like after if else block, this will be printed. Irrespective of whichever of those two blocks get executed, print thank you will be executed in both the cases because it is not a part of either of those two blocks.
Okay, ma'am.
Any questions till here?
No, ma'am.
Okay. I hope you guys have understood if else block. We'll continue tomorrow. We'll see elif also. Elif is basically used when, so basically if else is used in case you have only two options, right? As we saw, like a number can either be even or be odd. But if there are multiple options, then what to do that and all we'll see tomorrow. So yeah, if you still have any questions, if you come across any questions, so we can discuss that tomorrow. Cool.
No, ma'am.
Today. Yes, ma'am. No questions, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Shaina, I think I can wind up for today.
Okay, Priya. Anyone has any queries?
students?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay. No, ma'am.
It's okay. Yeah. Okay, Priya, then we can stop.
Okay, fine.